I am proud today to introduce Maryland's own Jeffrey Selingo. He and his family live in Chevy Chase, Maryland, and according to his book cover, he has written about higher education for two decades and is the former editor of the Chronicle of Higher Education. I've read a few books in my life, but I have never dealt with the subject, There is Life After College. And I can tell you that when I was in college, I sure hope there was, and that I could live through a few of my courses as well. And of course, my parents were in that same idea that they wanted me to finish and do something. This book is about what parents and students should know about navigating school to prepare for the jobs of tomorrow. And I guess that says it all. Mr. Selingo talks about the sprinters, the wanderers, and the stragglers. And I could tell you about them, but I have a feeling you would much rather hear it from him. Could we please give a great Gaithersburg Book Festival welcome to Jeff Selingo? Thank you very much.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about the book and then open it up for questions that you may have about this. As Sydney mentioned, I've been writing about higher education for nearly two decades. I've spent a lot of time with students, parents, professors, college presidents, and those who hire students over the last 20 years. And in writing this book, I've been thinking a lot, especially at this time of year. You know, it's graduation season right now on most college campuses, including this weekend. And so I started thinking about my own transition from higher education to the workforce 21 years ago when I graduated from college. And a few weeks after I graduated, I took off to Arizona with my college roommate, who today is the anchor of ABC World News, David Muir. And I landed at the Daily Newspaper in Phoenix, Arizona, where I showed up on the first day of a summer internship that I had for that summer after college. And the editor saw me and she said, "Well, you look young. You must know something about technology. Our technology reporter is on leave for the summer, and we need somebody to cover technology." And so, and this is 1995. And for those of you who remember, this is essentially the birth of the internet. It was a year after the first commercial web browser was introduced. And literally for that summer, I was explaining to the world, or to the readers in Phoenix, what the World Wide Web was. So I would do stories on the letters WWW. I would do stories on internet cafes. At that time, these internet cafes, of course, were desktop computers, not laptop computers, that you brought to the cafes. I did a story on the first airline that was on the internet. That was Southwest Airlines, where at the time you could look up the timetable for Southwest Airlines, but you literally had to pick up the phone and still call to make a reservation. So why do I tell you this story? I tell you this story because little did I know at that time, back in 1995, as I was writing about the birth of the internet for the Arizona Republic, that what I was writing about would actually disrupt not only my own industry within a decade, the journalism industry, but almost every other industry out there, and that technology would change forever. Many jobs, many occupations, and many industries, to a point where today entire careers are expanding and contracting at such an alarming pace. And what does that mean for today's college graduates? So it used to be that you could graduate from college, you would enter an occupation, and while you might have multiple careers over the course of your lifetime, you probably would follow very similar career tracks. It's, for example, the career track that I wanted to follow in journalism for the next 30 years, and little did I know, again, that it would be disrupted in that way. And today, in many ways, I think in these next couple of weekends, as students graduate from college, we almost have to give them a navigational chart. Because they're going to be kind of in the wide open seas in their careers. And I saw this in the last couple of years as I've reported about life after college. And that piece of paper that you get on college graduation, that degree that you get at college graduation, is no longer the only signal that you're job ready. It used to be that as long as you had that piece of paper, you were golden in the job market, right? You could get almost any job. And now there's a lot more noise around that degree. And in fact, today, nearly 50% of recent college graduates are underemployed, meaning they're in jobs that don't require a bachelor's degree. And in many ways, the degree has become an admission ticket for any job, not just those high-paying white-collar jobs that decades ago they used to be, that degree used to give you. And that requires us to think much differently about what comes after high school for students today. And that's what I want to talk about today, is what are the pathways that students are taking for career success after college? Because it's become much more critical, and I lay this out in the book, it's become much more critical about how you go to college than in some cases where you go, and even in a few cases, even if you go, right? Because that degree is no longer that golden ticket to a job, there's a lot more questions about what it buys you in the job market. And I want to talk a little bit about this new economy. So over the last 2 years, I've spent time with employers of all sizes and all kinds. Big employers such as Facebook and Google, smaller employers, both for-profit companies, government agencies, nonprofits, the stalwarts of what I call the campus recruiting tour, which includes, you know, the Macy's of the world, and Enterprise Rent-A-Car, which, believe it or not, hires more college graduates than any other company in America. And what I wanted to know from them is, what are the skills that they're looking for in today's college graduates and not necessarily getting? And when I first started talking to them, I expected them to give me a list of specific hard skills, right, that they weren't getting in today's students. Because I heard about this skills gap so often as I started reporting this book. And I thought that the skills gap was that students, new graduates from colleges, couldn't do a specific job that this employer was looking for them to do. But what I heard over and over again was what they were actually missing were the so-called soft skills. Those skills, working in teams, communication, skills that actually complement technology and in many ways keep you one step ahead. That human element to the skills development that many students unfortunately don't have today. And what I heard from them over and over again was that it was the soft skills that they were missing, not the hard skills. And in some ways, I think we need to start redefining what we mean by the soft skills and perhaps even call them the hard skills because they seem so hard to teach. And so what I heard over and over again was a list of skills, and many of these probably won't surprise you, and I lay these out in chapter 2 of the book. And again, I heard these from employers, big and small, for-profits, nonprofits, technology companies, and companies that have been around for 100 plus years. And what were they? Curiosity, this idea of lifelong learning, that you're not going to necessarily work for one company or in one occupation that's going to direct your learning for the rest of your life. So it used to be, as I described earlier, that if you once you graduated from college, if you worked for one company or in one industry for the rest of your life, somebody else would direct learning for you, right? Professional development for you. They would tell you what you needed to get and when you needed to get it. And in many cases, they would pay for it. Those days are over. You know, many more people are working in a gig economy. They're not necessarily working for a company, or they don't necessarily are part of a guild or a professional association that tells them what they need to know. And so they want students and new graduates who have this curiosity to consistently and constantly learn. Grit, this idea that you have resilience in the face of pressure, this ability to take on many tasks at once and prioritize. And I'll talk a little bit more about this in a second. Creativity, this idea that unlike school, no one is giving you a list of tasks to do every day. There's no syllabus to follow, right? There's no schedule to follow, and you kind of have to come up with it on your own, and you need to have that creativity. Digital awareness. Most jobs now, almost all jobs, have a technology element to them. Most jobs are tech jobs in some way, and most young adults graduating from college today have a passive relationship with technology. They don't necessarily understand the underlying technology of those things they look at all day, or all of us look at all day. So they might be called digital natives, but they don't necessarily know that underlying technology. Contextual thinking, right? This, what I call in the book, the killer app of this century. That's the ability to navigate both disciplines and networks, sometimes called the skills of the T-shaped individual. So somebody who has both broad thinking across disciplines and across subjects, so can think both broadly, but also can think deeply about one subject and knows one subject. And finally, humility, right? So that not everyone gets a promotion on the second day of work, right? So humility, I heard over and over again. In many ways, the conversations that I had with these employers over the last couple of years for the book mirrored a finding by Burning Glass, which is a company outside of Boston. And they do data analytics around job ads. So what they did last year was they scanned 20 million job ads that were online. And what they wanted to find out is, what were the skill sets in those job ads? What were the skill sets that kept appearing over and over again? And they wanted to know the baseline skills, those skills that kind of get you in the door. And so 20 million job ads in all kinds of industries, all kinds of occupations. And here's what they found. In 4 out of 5 job ads, the same 25 skills kept coming up over and over and over again. 4 out of 5 of those 20 million job ads. And in fact, in most of them, the same top 5 skills kept coming up over and over again. And what were those? Communication and writing, organizational skills and planning, problem solving, detail oriented, so all very soft skills. And there was one very specific hard skill, Microsoft Excel. So I always tell students, no matter what you major in, as long as you know Microsoft Excel, you're probably going to be pretty golden in the job market. But as Matt Singelman, who is the CEO of Burning Glass and led this study, told me, you know, if you've ever hired somebody for a job and or you've ever applied for a job, you know that most job ads list requirements that they're normally not going to get in people, right? They're not going to put a requirement in a job ad that most people will have. And so the fact that these employers had to put all of these soft skills in these job ads was a signal that they're no longer getting them embedded in the bachelor's degree like they used to. And why is that? Why is the bachelor's degree no longer that very strong signal of job readiness? And the big part of it is that we still have a bachelor's degree that was really designed for a very different economy and for a very different student. When you think about it, and I trace the history of the bachelor's degree, it doesn't sound as boring as it is in the book, but I trace what it turns out to be a very interesting history of the bachelor's degree in the book. And it basically goes back to the founding of the country. We imported the idea of the bachelor's degree from Europe, the idea of a 4-year bachelor's degree, freshmen, sophomore, juniors, and seniors. At the time, Harvard University at the time thought about a 3-year degree. In fact, they tested one for a couple of years, and then they went to a 4-year degree at some point within that first decade of their founding. And of course, because they were Harvard, everybody else followed them. And so since then, we've had this 4-year degree. But at that time, very few people went to college, right? The idea that to get into a career or get into an occupation, you would enter it through an apprenticeship or an internship or some sort of hands-on training. You didn't have to go to college as this gatekeeper to get a job. So very few people went to college at the time. So the bachelor's degree was designed for very specific occupations, usually statesmen and the clergy and the law and a couple of other occupations. But for the most part, people entered the occupations through actually hands-on learning. Now, fast forward a couple of centuries, and the bachelor's degree, for the most part, has the same structure as it always has, but the economy, number one, has changed. And number two, the number of students going into higher education has changed. And just in the last 30 years, we've had 8 million more students pursue higher education on an annual basis than we did back in the 1980s. But yet, our education system is still the same. And in many ways, as I started talking to these employers and observing their workplaces, I started to look at their workplaces as places that were becoming more like school used to be, and in many ways like elementary and preschool used to be. So I have a 6-year-old and a 4-year-old at home, and I was in my daughter, who's in kindergarten. They were remodeling her school when she was in kindergarten, and they just put a bunch of boxes in a room, and they let her and her classmates play with them for a couple of hours. And it was the highlight of the week, probably the month for her. And she talked about all the different things she made with those boxes, right? They made a town and a fort and all these other things. And as she was telling me this, I realized I was working on this book at the time. I realized, what if we did that with today's college students, right? What if we put them in a room just full of cardboard boxes? They would ask plenty of questions, of course, right? Do I have to work in groups, right? What's the assignment? How do I get graded on this, right? They would ask all these questions. And so we start off in many ways in the right way with this kind of cooperative education, play-based education. And then at some point, we move into a very rote form of education, sitting in rows like this with a professor at the front of the room. And of course, education is directed for people by somebody else, right? A parent, a teacher. And then of course, when students get to college, a syllabus or a course catalog, delivers education for them. And so this is a very different from the way the workforce is working today. And so I was talking to the head of learning for Xerox, and he was telling me that he noticed that people, their new employees, they know how to take a course, but they don't know how to learn. So he asked their new employees every couple of years, he asked their new employees what professional development opportunities they want. So this is Xerox. They hire thousands of new college graduates every year. And he asked them, what new professional development opportunities do you want to have? And in the last couple of years, one kept rising to the top, and it was time management. They kept asking for time management. He thought, wow, these are college students. I always thought they knew how to manage time. And so he put together some small groups to find out why they needed to learn how to manage time. And he realized that for most of their life, up until this point, somebody has managed their schedule for them, whether it was parents and teachers in K-12, and then increasingly in higher ed. So the syllabus basically laid out when a paper was due, when a book was due, a syllabus in many ways is a recipe for how to get an A. And then, of course, college in itself is very time-based, very task-based, right? You show up in September, you take a list of four or five courses, you have many breaks. Wish we had those breaks again. You come back in the spring, then you take another break in the summer, and you do that for 4 years. And then you enter the workforce, where it's much more today a mashup of activities where there's much more ambiguity in your day-to-day world, and there's no scheduled end. And what he was finding, and many other employers I was finding or hearing from, was that these students didn't know how to navigate the ambiguity of the workplace. They were very used to this linear world, and they were entering into a much more unstructured world. And in many ways, students coming out of college don't know how to navigate those linear structures that they're in, the college and university themselves. I talk about two significant reports in the book. One, a couple of years ago, called Academically Adrift, that was made into a book, which found that a third of college students, of the 24 colleges and universities that these two sociologists studied, had no learning gains over 4 years. No learning gains over 4 years. And then last year, a study that came out from the Collegiate Learning Assessment, so this is a test given to freshmen and to seniors to measure their critical thinking skills, found out that 40% of today's college graduates fail to graduate with the critical thinking skills needed to succeed in today's workforce. And I saw this firsthand in the book. So I went out to Oregon State University, which is one of the fastest growing universities in the country right now, in Corvallis, Oregon. And I went out there to interview an expert on emerging adulthood, this idea that today's young adults are just taking longer to launch into life. His name is Rick Setterstein. And he invited me to sit in on one of his classes. So this was the fall a couple of years ago, and these were seniors in college, seniors at the Oregon State University. And the conversation at one point, it was a lecture hall, there were probably about 300 students in the class, and at one point, the conversation turned to what they're going to do after college. Again, these are all seniors, and what they're going to do after college. And he said, well, how many are you going to go on to graduate school or professional school at some point? And probably more than 50% of the hands went up. I was actually surprised at how many hands went up. And then he said, how many of you know a professor well enough to ask for a recommendation? 5 or 6 hands went up, right? So 300 kids in the class, more than probably 150 of them going to graduate school. Only a couple hands went up when he said, how many of you know a professor well enough? And the question came, well, why not? How do you, can you have been here for almost 4 years and not know a professor well enough? And so the conversation then turned to why not? And he said, how many of you have been to office hours? Well, a few hands went up. And he said, and some of the students said, well, we didn't know we could go to office hours unless there was a problem. And the whole conversation turned to about how nobody ever told them how to navigate the institution. And we see this in surveys, for example. 50% of today's college seniors never talk to a professor about their career plans. Never. 50% of college seniors. So we had a lot, we have many more students than this group I met at Oregon State who are wandering through college. And so in many ways, as Professor Setterstein told me at the end of that class, he said a lot of what college comes down to is not what happens in the classroom, but it's about navigating life and building relationships to launch after college. And so why are so many students failing to launch after college? So for the book, Sydney mentioned in the intro, for the book, I conducted a survey of people in their mid-20s. I wanted to find out, how do people today launch into adulthood? And so we did a nationally representative survey of people in their mid-20s, and we wanted to find out what were the activities over the previous decade that led them to where they are today. And we ended up putting them into 3 buckets. They either launched into their 20s as sprinters, wanderers, or stragglers. And a third of them were sprinters, meaning that they jumped right into their career or graduate school. Not necessarily, so they weren't necessarily fast, but they were very determined in what they were going to do. They jumped into either their career or graduate school after college. And by their mid-20s, they were going. That was about a third of the students. Another third were wanderers. They took, at this point, they were in their mid-20s, and they're still, they had graduated from college, but they were still trying to figure out what to do. They had moved from job to job. They were permanent interns in some cases. And then the final third were what we had described as stragglers. These were people who took most of their 20s to get going. And in many cases, they still didn't have a college degree. So they had multiple courses, they had multiple credits, and still didn't have a college degree. So what were the key differences between these 3 groups? Again, a third, and a third of the sprinters, the wanderers, and the stragglers. 3 things differentiated these 3 groups. Number 1 was debt, was the level of higher education debt that they had. If you had, the less debt you had, the more likely you were to be a sprinter. Now, the sprinters, sometimes came from upper middle class and upper class families. They tended to have parents who went to college, but overall, the less debt they had, the more likely they were to be a sprinter. And the more debt they had, the more likely they were to be part of those other 2 groups. And why? Well, the average debt today of a college graduate is $30,000. The average debt of a sprinter was $10,000, right? And what ended up happening, and then I ended up meeting some of these students through the course of reporting for the book, is that the more debt you have at graduation, the fewer choices you have on what to do next, right? You have a lot less flexibility. So when you have that debt bill hanging over your head and it's going to show up on in your mailbox 6 months after college graduation, you can't move to a city where there may be new job opportunities because you don't have necessarily the financial flexibility. You can't take low-paid jobs in many cases. In many ways, this mirrors what happened in law schools 5, 6 years ago, where many students were so much into debt, their whole choice about which job to take after graduation all centered on how much it paid. So you have a lot less flexibility in what you can do. And so what ends up happening is you end up taking any job just to have a job because you have to pay for those bills. And you think, well, I'm only going to have that job for a couple of months, and then I'll eventually find something else. And what ends up happening is 6 months turns into a year, turns into 2 years, and turns into 3 years. And then I'm meeting these students in their mid-20s, and they're still wandering, trying to figure out what to do next. So the big differentiator, one of the big differentiators is debt. The second big differentiator, internships. This was really one of the big findings of the book. The more internships somebody had, the more likely they were to be a sprinter. In fact, 80% of the sprinters had at least one internship in college. Only 50% of the wanderers had an internship in college, and only 20% of the stragglers had an internship in college. And why is that important? Because in the last decade, the number of companies hiring only from their intern pools has skyrocketed after college graduation. So I have a number of career center advisors from different colleges tell me in the book that there are some companies that now won't recruit on campus at all for seniors, because they only want to recruit for interns. And in fact, at some big companies now, 80% of their new hires are coming from their intern pools. The bottom line is, if you didn't intern for them, you have no shot at getting a job. And why is that? Because they want to try these students out before they hire them. Because, again, it goes back to what I was talking about earlier. They don't necessarily think that the soft skills are embedded in that bachelor's degree like they used to be. So that was the number two differentiator, was this idea of the internships. The third one is the credential itself, right? Getting that credential. Now, this may seem like of course it does. The credential matters. But among the stragglers, 99% of them still didn't have a college credential. They didn't have an associate's degree. They didn't have a bachelor's degree. 99% of them. Now, that number might sound high to you, but today, out of the 40 million Americans who have some college credit and no degree, the largest proportion of those students are in their 20s. So we have more people in their 20s than any other age group today who have some college credit and no degree. So those were the three big differentiators: debt, internships, and getting that credential. And this is why it's so critical, right? Notice I didn't say you had to pick a specific major, you had to go to a specific school. This is why it's so important about how you go to college is much more important than where you go, or even in some cases, so if you go. So what can we do? What can we do to ensure that in the future, more students launch much more easily into their 20s from some sort of education? And I want to talk about three things quickly that I think that we can do, and I lay out in the book, and then I'll open it up for questions. The first is this idea of fail fast and fail cheap. Now, you may have heard that before. That's a mantra of startup companies everywhere. And the idea is that, you know, stop when you fail and tweak your idea before you spend too much money or too much time. And the problem is students don't do this enough, right? Students actually don't see many models of failure. They don't see good models of failure. I see this in terms of writing and presentations, right? Students always tell me, well, a paper is due on this day. They go and write it. They hand it in. They get a bunch of marks on it, and then that's it. They're done, right? Or there's a presentation due. They give the presentation. At some point, the professor gives them a grade on the presentation, usually on the content, not the presentation itself, and they're done. Right? And again, the workforce doesn't work this way, right? Much more of an iterative process in the workforce, whether you're working on a project or any type of work requirement, is going to be much more of an iterative process. And so we need to show and model failure much more for students, both in the home and in the school. And this is one of the reasons why I mentioned Enterprise Rent-A-Car earlier. So they hire more college graduates than any other company in America. And if you're a fan of March Madness, you'll note that they run commercials during March Madness that show college athletes working for Enterprise. They like hiring college athletes and first generation college students, because in both cases they've learned from failure, right? Think about a college athlete, right? They probably lost more games and matches than they've won. They had to show up for practice even when they didn't want to be there. They've learned the power of teamwork in many cases. And it's not just athletics, but it's other activities where somebody had to give a deep commitment to something, how to work in a deep commitment, many hours dedicated to it, whether it's music or drawing or art or some sort of activity where they had to give a deep commitment to it. And this is another reason they like first-generation students, who tend to have a bit more grit and resilience in the face of pressures. And it's one of the reasons why they like to hire them. And so again, we need to figure out ways to model failure both in the school environment and outside the school environment so that students are more prepared for that in the workforce. The second, so that's number one, is this idea of modeling failure. Second, we need to figure out how to create more work experiences for students while they're in school, whether it's even in high school or in college. So we are at, as a nation, the lowest level of employment for students while they're in school than we've been since the 1940s, right? There are fewer teenagers working today while they're in school than any other time in American history. So when I graduated high school in the early 1990s, 40% of teenagers worked while they were going to school. Today, 20% do. And why is that? Well, at the lower income levels, the jobs just don't exist, right? Those jobs now go to people who are back in the workforce or older students who are in college. And at the middle and upper income levels, students are too busy, right? They're too busy doing other things. And so fewer of them are working. And so what ends up happening, as I was talking to these employers over the last couple of years, is that students, their first work experience may actually be when they're an intern. Or in some cases, when they take that first full-time job after college, because for the most part, they're not necessarily getting any work experience, paid work experience while they're in college. Or in other cases, as I mentioned earlier, especially among those wanderers, they're not necessarily getting internship experiences either. And so to them, college is literally just going to classes, doing all the other activities that you do in college, and then you get out and then you start thinking about the world of work. And to me, and I profile a number of places in the book where the best models, I think, of education are ones that combine both the classic liberal arts of the classroom and the hands-on learning outside the classroom, whether that's co-ops and internships, at places like Northeastern University and the University of Cincinnati and Georgia Tech, which I talk about in the book. But this idea that we need to figure out a way to combine both the best of the work experience, the hands-on work experience in college, along with the classic liberal arts experience. Because, again, most employers are looking for that T-shaped individual, someone who's going to be broad across many subjects, but it's going to have detailed knowledge in one. And then finally, the third piece of what, in terms of how we can better launch students into their 20s, is that I think that we need to give students much more time in order to do it, right? This idea that you would go to high school 3 months after high school, you graduate from high school, 3 months later you go to college, 4 years later you graduate and go into the workforce, is really in many ways a relic of the post-World War II era, right? It was a point when returning GIs, because of the GI Bill, went to college largely for free. The post-World War II economy was booming. They got out, they got jobs, they got married, they started homes, they started families, right? And they did all that by the age of 24, 25. And every decade since then, the runway to adulthood has been getting longer and longer. And indeed, today, the average age of financial independence for college graduates is 30, right? 30. That's the point when they reach the median wage in the U.S. Back in 1982, it was 26, right? So it's been going up ever since then. But yet, we have this template that we try to put students through that we think, well, you're supposed to graduate from high school, go right on to college, and then go right into the workforce. But for many students, that's a very difficult road to travel, and they're having trouble doing that. And so we need to think of new ways to launch students into adulthood. And those include, and I talk about many of these in the book, so this idea that you know, 70% of high school graduates go right on to college 3 months after high school graduation, but only 50% of them graduate in 4 years, right? So what if, instead of forcing everybody right onto college 3 months after high school graduation, we had more gap year, transition year experiences out there? right? We've heard a lot, probably, and you probably heard a lot about the gap year in the last couple of weeks because of Malia Obama deciding to take a gap year. And a gap year is, I hate the name of it because I think it has this reputation for something that wealthy kids do and they go and backpack through Europe. But the fact of the matter is that the gap year experiences, the transition year experiences, as I like to call them, have been increasing in the last couple of years. There's now many more types of activities for students, including ones that don't that cost very little money. There's a program that I profile in the book up in Baltimore, where students get an academic experience. They partner with the University at Baltimore and the community college up there, so that students get to take academic courses. They get an internship. And they also get a mentor to help them figure out what they want to do next. And then a year later, they go on to college, right? And they go on to college much more mature, much more focused. In many cases that year, they decide not only what they want to do, but in some cases they decide what they don't want to do, right? Because most students at the age of 18 have very little clue about what they want to do. Probably most of you in your 40s, 50s, and 60s may still not have any clue about what you want to do. And most students pick something that's familiar to them when they go to college, right? What's the second question that most students get when they go to college, right? Or when somebody says they're going to college, right? The first question is, well, where are you going? And the second question is, what's your major going to be, right? And students think they have to pick that major, which is picking a career. And at the age of 18, very few students have had access to most careers. And so they pick something that their parents do, or their friends' parents do, or their neighbors do. And then 4 years later, they get to college graduation and they start looking at job ads. And one thing I heard over and over again was, it's like a foreign language. I didn't even know all these job titles existed. And at that point, it's kind of late, right? It's kind of late to kind of retool yourself for all those jobs that you didn't know existed. So if we spend more time before college, or before some sort of post-secondary education, because I think, again, we need to broaden the definition of this, I think that we will spend less time worrying about these students launching after college. And the same goes for while students are in college and giving them that those work experiences, those apprenticeships and internships. Again, not trying to rush them through. And then after college, I profile in the book a number of post-college now opportunities that help guide students into the workforce that didn't even exist as recently as 10 years ago. But overall, we need to rethink this timeline after high school. And the reason why we do it the way we do it is largely it's tradition and it's culture, right? This idea if somebody doesn't go right on to college after high school, we think they're a failure. And the second reason, of course, the big one is money, right? Is money. We think, well, if we just shove them through college as quickly as possible, they'll get into the workforce and they'll start making money. And as I note in my book and the survey I took of my book, is two-thirds of students don't launch right after college. They're wandering, they're straggling, and so they're not making necessarily the money, and they probably spent a lot more money on college than they should have. And so if they're much more focused before they go there, I think they'll end up in much better shape afterwards. So I started by talking about we're at this time of year of college graduation when most people get those diplomas. I'm sure many of you out in the crowd have those. How many of you have a college diploma? Okay, almost. How many of you have been asked in the last 5 years to show it to somebody for something? Okay, right. Okay. Oh, wow. Okay, amazing. Right, so my wife and I, so we've just moved to Maryland, and you probably, and if you've moved, you probably know there's always those boxes you move from place to place, right? So we've moved 3 or 4 times in the last 15 years, and there's this one box that we keep moving, and finally, it's not marked, and I looked in it, and I wanted to know what was in it. It was my college diploma and my transcript from college, and it was rolled up in the original tube that I got it in. So I've worked now for 20 plus years, and nobody has asked me for those two pieces of paper that we think are so valuable and that we pay so much money for. And I think the message of this book is those pieces of paper actually don't matter that much, right? It's what you do while you're there, what you do in those years after high school, what you do in college that matters a lot more to how you launch after college. I thank you for your time today. We have some time for questions and answers, and then I'll be signing books. Thank you.
Hi. What can I do before college to prepare myself for after college?
Okay. So I talked a little bit about work, getting some sort of work experience. It's so fascinating to me about how this has changed over the last 10 or 15 years. Is this so many students are not getting work experience at all, whether it's just a part-time job working literally even at McDonald's or the Gap, right? Those jobs that in my generation really taught you to show up on time. It taught you to work with people of different generations, right? Where you normally wouldn't, because for the most part, you've lived in a world of everybody of your own generation, right? It taught you the value of work. So that, to me, is one of the biggest things. Number two is, while you're in college, I get a lot of questions about what major should I pursue to get a job after college. And so many students, I think, wrongly try to pursue what they consider the hot majors of today. And the problem with the way the job market is changing now is that almost any major you pursue today might be almost extinct by the time you graduate in 4 years. So one example of this, petroleum engineering, right? Petroleum engineering 2 years ago was named the hottest college major because it was the number one job for new bachelor's degree recipients after college. It by far had more job openings than anything else, and it paid much, much higher than most other bachelor's degrees. Today, now 2 years later, it's not even in the top 10 of jobs, right? Because, as we know, the oil industry and the gas industry have changed drastically in just the last 2 years. And as I said in the beginning of my talk, I majored in journalism, right? Thinking that that career would be around for a very long time. And within a decade after I graduated, it changed drastically. So in terms of majors, I always tell people, pick a rigorous major, right? Pick a major where you're going to work really hard, where you're going to read a lot, where you're going to write a lot, or where you're going to have to do a lot of work in that major. Pick a major where you're going to have great mentors, right? So going back to that Oregon State story that I was telling you, right, where you're going to meet professors and get to know them well, and where other students are going to be good peers to you, right, and are going to push you hard. Whenever in the book, whenever I talk to somebody about how they got that internship or that job, most of the time it wasn't because of, a professor or the career office or anything else. It was because some other student, usually an upperclassman, told them to take it. So work and a rigorous major are two of the most important things that you could do. Yes, in the back.
Are you or other groups kind of working with universities to try to change the institutional nature of what's going on there to kind of help students navigate the system and get the mentorship and networking capacity? That's something I regret, from my undergrad years of why didn't I take more advantage of the professors?
Yeah. Like that. So I'm actually a professor of practice at Arizona State University. I go out there and I teach a couple times a year. And one of the things that they're doing, and I talk about this in the book, is that they're actually rethinking the whole degree pathway, right? So they have a project-based degree where you could get 40% of your credits through projects, not through actually taking classes. And you actually learn the subject working on the project. And one of the things that they noted is that, as when you go to most universities, you spend the first 2 years in core courses, general education, usually very large classes, and you don't know how that applies to the real world. Well, here is a case where starting your freshman year, you're starting to work on projects and you're learning theory and applying it at the same time, right? And it's really how most of us learn the best, right? We learn the best when we learn something and apply it almost in concert with each other. The problem, so that's, and that's one university. And there's a couple of other universities. Georgetown is doing some interesting things around this too, rethinking the degree. But for the most part, colleges don't think it's their job to get students a job, right? I think that's the biggest problem right now with higher education. Now, most parents and students think that, right? There's a survey that's done of college freshmen every year. So UCLA surveys college freshmen nationwide every year. And back in 2006, it turned for the first time, where the number, they asked, one of the questions they ask is what's the most important reason that you're going to college, and it used to be to like learn something. Now the number one reason is to get a job. Number two is to learn something. So we haven't given up on that idea that college is also for learning, and I strongly believe in that. But learning is for learning's sake is great, but at some point you need a job to pay off those debt. And the problem is most colleges believe that it's not their job. And until they do, I don't think they're going to change in that way. Yes,
now,
question
wait,
in the back.
I have a question. Right?
Oh, yes.
I took a different route in regards to getting my education. I'm just curious what you, in your book, and what you personally have to think about trade schools, because that's something that's always underlined and always forgotten, especially in this country, in regards to, because that, to me, the 2 years that I took for my associates didn't teach me anything, really. And then when I went to my trade school for 6 months, it was basically more knowledge than I could have accomplished in a 4 year. And I'm just curious what...
So I'm a big fan. I talk a lot in the book about apprenticeships and 2 year colleges particularly, right? So again, we have this cultural idea that what education after high school means is college. And for the most part, that college means a 4 year degree. And that's largely pushed by counselors in high school because for the most part, they are evaluated on how many, what the percentage of students they send on to college. They're very proud of it. Go to any high school around here, because I did it, and they're very proud of the percentage of students they send on to college. Of course, then you ask them, what's the, I hope there's no guidance counselors in the audience. Then you ask them, well, what happened to those graduates a year later? They have no idea, right? So in the book, I profile this apprenticeship program down in North Carolina, where this student, he was a senior, he was going into a senior year in high school, and he saw this sign in the guidance office for an apprenticeship at Siemens, you know, the big multinational German manufacturer. And he asked his guidance counselor about it, and his counselor said, oh, you don't want to do that. You're college-going material, right? This kid was taking AP courses. He was probably going to go to NC State to major in engineering. He ends up switching schools because his parents got a divorce, and he was really worried about paying for school. And so he went to this new school, and he ended up applying for this apprenticeship program, which he started, by the way, in high school. They paid him. They also paid him to go get his 2-year degree. By the time I met him in his mid-20s, he had already been promoted many times in this company. He had a 2-year degree. He had no debt. He was married, had kids, and his wife, the week I met him, had just finished her MBA and was unemployed, right? So he took this route that very few people take because we look down on it, and he ended up much better than his own wife after that pathway. And the problem is that in that case in North Carolina, there were 8 students in that program, right? I also profile the program in Walla Walla, Washington for John Deere tractors, right? I mean, part of the problem is everybody thinks these jobs are really just, you know, they're low-skilled and they're dirty, and they're not, right? In many cases, they're very high-skilled, right? So John Deere was having trouble finding enough people to repair its tractors. And so they started these programs with community colleges around the country because a typical John Deere tractor, which is a million-dollar-plus vehicle, has more than 25 different computers on it, right? So you need a 2-year degree. And this is the other issue is that most of the jobs in the future are going to be these middle skill jobs, right? Jobs that don't require a 4-year degree, but require some sort of education after high school, whether it's an apprenticeship or something else. And so I think this is one of the biggest issues that we're facing is that we need to encourage more of these pathways after education. So yes.
Wanted your athletic programs to be compliant. Things got better for athletes in universities.
It is changing. So the question is about employment outcomes, right? So for the most part, U.S. News and World Report measures inputs, right? It measures who's coming in the door, the strength of the student body, how much money the university spends on its faculty. In fact, I used to intern at U.S. News and World Report. Back in 1994, I interned on the College Guide. So I know exactly how those rankings are put together. And it's all about the more the universities spend, the higher they go in the rankings, right? It's totally, it totally is a perverse incentive that we have. And now, though, that's changing, not with U.S. News and World Report, but it's changing with other metrics. So, Money Magazine, The Economist, LinkedIn, all in the last couple of years have come out with rankings based on employment outcomes. Not only what is the percentage of students employed, they also look at what fields they're employed in, what companies they're employed with, and in some cases, they're even tying salary to this. We now have a couple of states that have tied their unemployment insurance databases. So Virginia does this. You could go on a public website in Virginia, look up college by major institution, and see the average starting salary in real time, because it's based on unemployment in aggregate, unemployment insurance records. So this is really changing, and I think in the next 10 years, we're going to be talking a lot more about this value and the value and outcome.
So can I'm sorry.
Yeah, I think we're going to start signing.
Well, but I actually had a question.
Oh, okay.
So I have this theory, and I look at college campuses, and I think we're investing this fortune in infrastructure, and it's like this. It's going to all be obsolete one of these, right? I mean, like, we need dorms and all these huge buildings.
But we don't need as many nice buildings as we have. I'll give you that, okay?
I mean, they're palaces.
We have spent too much on very nice amenities. I do not, and I wrote a previous book called College Unbound, which looked at the future of higher education. I am not a believer that in 20, 30 years, we're all going to be going to college online, right? You know, it's just not going to work because the power, the soft skills that I was talking about earlier, they are developed this way, right? They are developed face-to-face and in residential education. It doesn't mean technology won't play any role. It's going to play a very large role. We're still going to have residential campuses. So I don't think it's necessarily wrong to invest in buildings. Where I think it's wrong is to invest in buildings that cost twice as much as they really should. So I think we have time for one more question, and then I could take questions at the table as well.
Every time I go to the doctor's office, I see all these diplomas and certificates all over the wall. Is medicine a different career track than what you're talking about?
Yeah, I mean, I think the professional schools, for the most part, first of all, I think the bachelor's degree is always going to be some sort of signal of readiness for the job market because it shows employers that somebody had the discipline to start something they finished. So I don't think the bachelor's degree is going away. I think there's a lot more noise around it, and I think employers are looking for other ways to measure those soft skills. And I think that law, medicine, and maybe business. But where I think there's going to be a major disruption in the next 10 years is around professional master's degrees, certificates, and things like that. Most people pay way too much money to get professional master's degrees. And now, and I outline this in the book, there's all these new boot camps and other activities that allow you to get just what you need to get a job, the education you just need, and at a much lower price, and in some ways they guarantee a job without having to go to graduate school. And I'm not talking about graduate school to become a PhD to go teach, but graduate school, where there's been a big increase in the last 20 years, is to get a professional master's degree to put your, you know, to differentiate yourself in the job market. I think that's going to almost disappear in the next 20 years, because I think we are seeing now this just-in-time education phenomenon where you are going to get, instead of getting a full plate of a master's degree in your 20s, you're going to get pieces of that over your career because you're going to need to continue to go for education. So thank you very much for your time, and I'll be signing books over here. Thank you.